So my name is Sarah Kloth. I am the Director of Digital Strategy at Top Floor. Top Floor, we are a digital marketing and web development company located out in New Berlin. So when I first kind of applied to speak here, I was kind of thinking, okay, what am I going to talk about? What do I have to offer you guys? So I started thinking about these conferences and how we normally really get super hyped up about all the things that we see, and we're like, yes, we're going to leave, we're going to conquer the world and do all these great things. And then we find ourselves essentially, you know, unwinding on the weekend, forgetting everything we learned. We go back on Monday, and then we're like, okay, great, now where do I start? How am I going to do any of the things that I learned today? So with that, I was trying to think too, what do I have to offer you guys that you can will both inspire you as well as give you some actionable things to actually be able to take back with you on Monday. So with that, I came up with tools to automate and elevate your marketing efforts. So I'm going to be sharing a collection of different WordPress plugins and different other tools out there that I've used throughout my career that have really helped to both save time as well as to increase the performance of all my marketing campaigns. So who here all feels like this daily? For sure. We have content and information overload all the time. So what I'm going to try to do today is kind of, when I talk about automation here, is really to figure out ways that we can really refine what is important to us and what we should be focusing on and how we're going to save time. 74% of marketers say that the biggest benefit of automation is saving time. So I'm not going to be talking about the big, you know, price tag automation platforms out there, some that Ryan talked about just previously in here. I'm going to be more talking about things that, you know, are on the free side with the WordPress plugins that'll be able to save you guys time so you can go away from that content and information and task overload and be able to really focus in on some of the more important aspects of your business. So hopefully by the end of this, you'll be able to kind of sit back and start, you know, watching some of these more minuscule tasks that you normally do kind of work themselves as well as elevate the performance. But before we start and get into all the different tools that I have today for you guys, we need to identify where we're going. So with that, we want to really make sure that we focus in and have an actual digital marketing strategy. So again, kind of piggybacking off of what Ryan talked about a little bit before here, is making sure that you have that your goals and everything listed of what you're going to do out for the year so that you can identify what those goals are and make sure that you're matching them up with the efforts and the tools that you're integrating into your WordPress site to be able to actually accomplish great things with that. So these goals could be something as simple as, you know, you just want to increase your contact list. You want to get more leads coming in from the website. Maybe you really want to take a social media initiative this year and make sure that we have, you know, a higher increased social engagement. Maybe you really want to amp up your content marketing. You could do that as well. And then just some simpler things too, you know, say you have a good grasp on your digital marketing, but this year you're like, okay, we're doing all of the things, we're doing SEO, we're doing PPC, we're doing content, but we really want to identify and be more strategic or do more testing this year. So once you have all of this in plan, then you're like, okay, now that we know where we want to go, how are we going to identify the steps to take and how are we going to have all the time to do to be able to make these things great? The answer is there is an app for that. So these are a few collection of some of the tools. Some of them have been talked about a little bit today so far that I'm going to really kind of talk about as far as how I've implemented these and the benefits that I saw from those. So the first one here is something called SumoMe. This is a free WordPress plugin out there. It's great for if you've identified with your marketing initiatives that you really want to increase your lead generation, if you really want to build your contact list, or generally if you just have a newsletter, something that no one's signing up for, and you're putting a lot of efforts into, you know, marketing and sending out these newsletters with no one really there on the other end to receive them. So SumoMe, it's a free plugin, like I said. It comes with a whole suite of different tools out there that are available. There's a lot of great things here based on what your strategy is for the year. Things for identifying what your visitors are doing, where they're clicking on your site, things that'll help increase those leads coming in, as well as just some other kind of social media aspects too. So there's three key pieces to this that I'm gonna talk about specifically that we've added. The first one here is called List Builder. It's these annoying pop-ups that everyone here probably hates. But luckily, they have a lot of great benefits within this tool to make them not those annoying plugins that we see. So when you download this plugin inside of WordPress and you install or activate the List Builder, you're going to see a screenshot like this, where you're going to be able to fully customize these pop-ups. You're going to be able to match them specifically to the colors of your website, to the messaging that you want, and be able to kind of fully customize the size as well. So when we say annoying, don't cover the entire page with this pop-up. You know, make it nice and kind of discreet a little bit as to not annoy them. With this as well, you can set up different behaviors and rules that these pop-ups are going to do. So the last thing you want to do is say, okay, on every page have this pop-up come up, no matter if they've been to my website before or not. You can set rules that say, okay, if someone's been to my website already and they click the X and they don't want to sign up, don't show it to them again. Don't continuously put this in front of them if they already don't want it. Another thing too is you can decide which pages it wants to show up. So more than just email signups, this is a great aspect, say, if you have some gated content pieces. So maybe you have a great ebook out there and you've identified, okay, if someone is on these five pages of my website, we have an ebook that's related to these topics. So we want this pop-up specifically to show on these five pages where they can submit their email addresses and then get that ebook. You can also set all the different form fields, so you could harvest things like name, company name, email addresses, whatever you want to essentially set up there. You can add different fields as well. Another great thing about this tool is it automatically connects into your email programs. So you don't have to go inside of WordPress, see if anyone's filled this out, grab those email addresses, put them inside of your MailChimp or your Constant Contact for them to be able to, again, be part of these newsletter lists. So it's kind of that seamless integration. The one thing too about this is they offer reporting on the back end as well, and they can also export all those different contents too. So you can see, okay, out of all the different list builders that I've created, which ones are performing the best, which ones are getting the more signups. Maybe you're doing some A/B testing in there as well to test different messages and colors. You can easily kind of pull these reports out and get some information from that as well. But again, 100%, we do not want to be annoying to our audience and turn them off. Regina George said it best, don't be obsessed with your audience. You don't want to keep pushing that in front of them. It's kind of like makeup, the less is more aspect with these pop-ups. Another one here is called Smart Bar. This is kind of like List Builder, but it is the kind of subtle banners that you might see at the top of a screen or the bottom of a screen. Sometimes they float along with you as you're scrolling up or scrolling down a page. So if you know, don't want to get on the pop-up bandwagon, this is a nice kind of subtle way to be able to kind of ask for those email addresses as well. Same aspect, you're going to see everything you saw with the last one in here. Again, being able to change colors, form fields, anything essentially, and all without having to get your developers involved as well. So with this too, again, easily you can manage a lot of different behaviors. One great behavior on this that they allow you to do is what's called the intent to leave. So say someone's on your website, they're reading your blog post, you know, they don't see that bar yet, but the second they start scrolling up to essentially leave, then you see that pop up and that bar show up for them to kind of put it at the forefront. The third one inside SumoMe that I want to talk about is called Social Share. What this is, you've probably seen it all over the place. You've probably seen it on all those different main media sites out there. All this does is really allows you to easily connect your social media sharing abilities with your content. So what it does is you can kind of connect all your different services, decide which types of social media platforms that you want to show here. So you're like, okay, if your audience doesn't use Facebook, let's disclude Facebook from this. Let's maybe add in the email option instead. So there's a lot of great different services available with this that you can customize based on what you feel your audience would want to utilize. And again, you can utilize different layouts. It can be on the side, on the bottom, whatever you want to kind of see that doing. It can float with the scroll. So there's a lot of different options for display rules in this. Another great piece to this is if you're worried about your mobile users on those smaller screens, there is a way for them to, a mobile optimized section here where you can either turn that off completely or you can, make it not scroll with you anymore, only be kind of stagnant in one spot. So there's a lot of great things with that as well. So we added these looking at the list builder and smart bar. What we did here is we added these features instead of your kind of basic where you might have your sign up for a newsletter in the footer or on a sidebar or something like that. So who all here, based on this, thinks that the percent increase in newsletter signups was under 25%? No one? Wow. Okay. Between 50 and 100? All right. And then anyone for over 100%? A few of you in the back? All right. We actually saw a 760% increase on this. Just by getting those kind of stationary newsletter signups from the footer and the sidebars and kind of putting them in front of your users.
You were using all of them or specific ones?
Yep. We were using, for this one specifically, a combination of the list builder and the smart bar. So I know you're thinking, OM Goat, 760% increase. We also did this with the simple social shares, and we saw a 680% increase in the amount of people that were actually sharing our content out there. Double OM Goats, 760 plus 600%, that's a great thing, great benefit with this tool overall. The second one here, something called title experiments. This one is really great for A/B testing your headlines of your content. So headlines are super important. They're what's gonna get people to click into your content, to share your content, to start reading your content. It's kind of that snippet of text that's gonna be able to see if someone's interested in kind of engaging with your content. Who's all here guilty of sharing articles out there just by the content of the title without even reading it? I do that on the daily, especially on Twitter. Like, oh, this seems interesting, I'll just retweet it. So this is a great plugin to be able to kind of increase your traffic from a different plugin or different platforms, engage your users, and then increase your overall shares. So when it comes to A/B testing, who here all knows how to accurately A/B test? All right, that's what I thought. So I think a lot of us were like, yeah, we've heard of A/B testing. We're going to try some things. We're going to write some headlines and see what happens. So you start getting everything ready, and you're like, yes, I'm going to Bill Nye the shit out of this. I got all these headlines going. I'm going to insert some great buzzwords. I got my thesaurus out, and I'm going to just be ready to test all of this. You get super hyped. You write all this content. You post it out there, and then you're impatiently kind of sitting there waiting, and you're like, okay, which one's going to be better? How long do I wait? When should I kind of cut the cord on one and push it all to the rest? And then you kind of gather this data, and then you go from Bill Nye to this, where you're like at the eye doctor and you're like, okay, is it one or is it two? I'm not really sure which one's working here. And then you just get aggravated and you're like Lindsay Lohan here and you're like, the limit doesn't exist, I give up. And you guys just go right back to what you were doing before and you just write one headline and continue blogging. So this is a screenshot of a real email that I got from a client. It says, hey Sarah, I have a question for you. I hear all about A/B testing, trying different phrases, title links, word choices for getting the most hits, all these SEO optimized tests and trials to run on content. I can't figure out who is this audience that's testing being done on. Is this a magical trial environment land where exciting people who press buttons they prefer? Or are companies simply just, pushing out live versions of titles they want to test, collecting and modifying, optimizing, and constantly updating and changing to figure out what's best? So this really inspired me for this client to find a solution for her where she can be able to test different headlines and titles of her content without having to, get into the details of all that data to figure out what's going on. So that's where I found title experiments. This is, again, a free WordPress plugin that you can install. It does A/B testing for titles of your posts and your pages. So what you'll see once you download this plugin, when you go to make a new post out there, you'll now see multiple headline fields. So you can write as many as you'd like with this, And what it's gonna do is, once you publish that content, it's gonna start randomly selecting which title that you wanna push out there. What title's gonna be displayed when someone shares it, what title's gonna be displayed when someone views the page, and it'll start gathering all of that data for you. You can also set rules where it's like, okay, if, you know, run this test for 1 month, and then once, you know, we figure out what the champion is here for the headline, cut the rest off and let's continue with that headline. I know a lot of SEOs in the room are probably freaking out at me right now, going, oh my gosh, my H1 tags, you're changing them. There are SEO-friendly options inside of title experiments in their settings in WordPress. So you'll be able to kind of say, okay, here, yeah, we're doing a test right now, but this is the main headline that I want you to see. It'll be able to kind of push that to Google to say, hey, here's my actual SEO title right now. And then while you're doing that test, it'll still display and be crawled with that one title until you find that champion, and then you can switch it out.
This is called title experiments?
Correct, title experiments.
.com?
Within WordPress, if you just go to the plugins, you can search for a new plugin to add. And if you just type in title experiments, it should pop up for you.
Okay.
Experiments?
Yes. So I pulled a few experiments that were actually inside of title experiments as kind of some case studies that they did. So I want to get a kind of a gauge of what you guys think the champions here were. So we have A, how I used this blog to replace my day job, and B, how I grew this blog from $100 a month to a full-time income. How many here think it's A? How many think it's B?
That was a champion?
A was the champion. All right, I have another one here. A, get organized with the best, or B, clean, bright, organized. How many think A? How many think B?
I think
A. I know, so you're like, okay, I was A-B testing, I was getting my headlines, I got my buzzwords in here, this is really catchy. It doesn't perform. One more. Passionate about betting. We are too. Make more money on your bets, get free betting tips, or C, stop losing money on your bets, get daily betting tips.
B.
How many think A?
B.
B?
B.
B. C?
C.
It's B.
Okay.
So, what we kind of learned here is we're not going to know. You know, we can guess as much as we want to guess what we think, you know, how creative we were with our headlines. But until we kind of get that data, we're really not going to know. Yeah?
Like your client wrote, who is the audience that's giving, or where are the results coming from? Is it just how many kids are getting?
These ones here specifically are just a case study that this plugin put out there. But overall, title experiments will pull from your actual direct audience.
Now, do you know how that converts, or it just tests the clicks?
It tests the click-through rates.
Okay.
Yeah. Yep.
How close were they? Was it a large margin between the titles, or were they very close?
I don't have the actual data here. I don't know exactly what that was. All right. So, we took a lot of this through a few different clients and kind of gathered a bunch of data. This is just talking about the clicks that we saw. So with this, what percent increase in clicks to our content from shares do you think that we saw the increase here? Anyone for under 25? Between 25 and 75? You're all going big, huh? Over 100? 220% increase. So we had kind of a without line and then a with the A-B testing line to kind of see what the benefits really were here. And again, this is a combination of a bunch of different ones out there that we kind of pulled together to do kind of an overall case study with us. So you go from Bill Nye not understanding, and I'm like, girl, I get it, I understand it, we're gonna be A-B testing. So, third one here, publicize for Jetpack. So I know a few speakers here have talked about Jetpack a little bit already, and I'm probably sure a lot of you have Jetpack installed, but you probably don't know about or have utilized what's called social media automation within here. This is a segment inside of Jetpack that's gonna be great as far as if your marketing initiatives are really about increasing social media traffic and increasing social engagement. So, the average marketer spends about 1 hour per blog post scheduling out all of the different social media for that. So you have that piece of content, you've pushed your blog post out, and now you want to go through and you want to schedule out on Facebook, on Twitter, for the day of, a few hours later, a week later, etc. So, what would you do if you got that hour back? You could do, you know, the basic catching up on emails, you could go to lunch with a colleague, you can, you know, brainstorm on a project, or if you really just want to waste that hour, you know, you can actually listen to 16 different covers of Taylor Swift's Shake It Off. So, get your hour back with this plugin. So once you download this piece from Jetpack, what you can do is it'll ask you to connect your social media accounts. So you can log into your Facebook, into your Twitter, into all of those different aspects. It supports Twitter, Facebook, Tumblr, Pinterest, LinkedIn, Google+. And once you do install this, what you're gonna see is now, when you're on that screen to publish your piece of content, you're gonna see some other settings underneath there that's gonna ask you to check the different accounts that you want to post this blog on as well. So once, yep. This is in Jetpack. It's called Social Media Automation.
Oh, in the free version?
Correct.
Wow. Can you schedule there too, or is it automatic?
It's coming. It's coming. So this tool specifically, again, so it, what it's going to do, it's going to hook up to your accounts. So you're going to say, okay, with this blog post, schedule it to, yeah, Twitter, to Facebook, and LinkedIn. And with that, instead of automatically pulling content, what it's going to think, you know, what you normally see when you automate some of this stuff, it's going to ask you to write your custom message. So you're not going to see that weird awkwardness sometimes that you see when you try to automate social media posts.
And we'll then have a link back.
Yep. So then once you fill all this out and you're ready to send and publish out that new piece of content, once you hit that publish button, it's going to publish to your blog, and then it's going to shoot it all to all the different channels that you've connected to it as well.
Can you do a different message per social account, or is it one message
It is one message for all currently, yeah. It's a little bit of a downside on it. So that's that, but wait, there's more. If you combine that with the fourth tool here called Revive Old Posts, this is going to be, again, great for different content exposure as well as increasing your social engagement. So with the other one, what it did is it sent to all of your social media platforms right away on that first publish. This one is what it's going to do is it's going to allow you to create a schedule to kind of revive those old posts and send them out to your social media platforms. So on average, on that side, what we see is the majority of us are spending 6 or more hours a week on just scheduling out all of these different posts. So that's almost equivalent to a full workday. Some of us are a little extreme here, it seems like, 21 plus hours a week on our social media. So this allows you to kind of cut some of this time out. So what this does when you install this, again, this one's called Revive Old Posts. It supports all the main different plugins, and what it does is it allows you to kind of start creating a pot of posts that you want to get into kind of this bucket to start sending out to your social media platforms. So you can say, okay, if I have an old blog post that's older than, let's say, 30 days, we want to put it into this pot. And then what we want to do is we want to share how many posts per week. Let's say, okay, within that pot now that we have, let's share 3 of these posts per week. And let's figure out, you know, how often and frequent we want to post those. With that as well, to kind of figure out what that pot is that it's going to schedule out, you can decide what types of post types within WordPress that you want to schedule. So is it just your blog posts? Is it, you know, product pages? Anything like that that you have as far as post types in WordPress go? And then what you can do also, which is really great to see what the efforts are of this plugin versus your own efforts for scheduling out posts. There's a little checkbox here for Google Analytics campaign tracking. So what that's going to do is it's going to allow you to see with inside of your Google Analytics exactly which posts that this was accounted for actually got clicks into your website. So we'll be able to kind of judge what that interaction is there. With that too, since this is kind of going to automate a little bit and you don't want it to get out of hand, you want to really make sure that you use the exclusion and inclusion list. So you want to make sure that, you know, if you have a category about events that are coming up within your blog post, you're probably going to want to exclude them from this bucket. So you don't want to tweet out an event that happened 2 months ago. So you can do this by, you know, different categories of your posts, as well as looking at different post types to exclude. You can also select which type of image size that you want. When you incorporate images into your WordPress, a lot of the times it'll automatically make a thumbnail, a large, a medium size. So you kind of figure out what that size is. You'd also like to schedule with that. As well as, a lot of you have probably seen this, if you follow any big news sites at all, what they do is they use this to schedule out a kind of a weekend post. So they say, okay, curate all the content that happens throughout the week, and then you'll see posts like on Twitter that's like, in case you missed it, here's what we scheduled for the week. What you can do with this tool as well is you can add text before or after that it's gonna send out for all these social media posts. So automatically it's gonna grab your title and it's gonna grab a snippet of that post and then the link to back to your blog. But then you can say, okay, precedent this with from the old archives or something like that. As well as you can add hashtags to the end too if you're using it for Twitter. If you know that there's some hashtags that are always gonna be relevant, you can automatically add those hashtags to it. So just by utilizing this, we saw an increase in our blog visits via our social media. And what do we think the results were here? Anyone for under 25 this time? Nope. Between 25 and 50? All going big, you've learned. Over 50%? Gotcha. 40% increase. So you can see kind of about September that we turned this on, and we can see how that's kind of increased the amount of visits that we were getting just by being able to frequent out those blog posts a little bit more. A lot of the times we saw, you know, you have a blog post, you schedule it out, maybe you'll schedule it out a few more weeks, then you just forget about it. So just by being able to revive some of these old posts that we had out there, we saw a lot more engagement and traffic coming in. Number five. So I know I was told you I wasn't going to talk about the big price tag automation tools, but who all here even had an idea or acknowledged that there was a free version of HubSpot? Had no clue. One of you. Awesome. Two of you. It was formerly called something called Lead In. This is great for lead generation and lead nurturing. So if you're looking for something to better connect your marketing efforts with your sales efforts and having those teams talk a little bit more together, this is a great thing to kind of utilize without having to be bogged down by switching into HubSpot's platform or anything like that. So what HubSpot offers, it's actually a plugin for WordPress that you can go and download. And once you download that, it's going to put a snippet of code on your website to be able to start tracking this. The most important strategic goals of marketing automation strategy are increasing lead generation, lead nurturing, and sales revenue. I think we can all agree that these are some of the big kind of narrowed down big ticket items as far as marketing goes. And that's kind of where HubSpot comes in to be able to do some of these things. So who here all feels like this when they're like, okay, marketing team, what have you contributed to our pipeline this week? You know, what's going on? And then you kind of like ignore the question. You're like, we got you traffic. Someone filled out a form. But then that's that missing piece to filled out a form versus actual closed sales. So this is where HubSpot comes in too. So what this is gonna do is it's gonna be able to find out who's on your site. It gets a little creepy. It's going to be able to tell you what pages they visited and give you some context to those conversion points that you see. It's going to be able to deliver customized reports to see, okay, how many interactions does a user normally have on my website before they actually fill out a form? What pages do they normally come through? What is that pipeline before they actually fill out that contact form or download a PDF, whatever that might be? And it actually connects straight into your email program too. So like I said, if you use this tool from before, like SumoMe, and you're harvesting emails and stuff like that, you don't have to go into the tool and then put it in to your email program. It's automatically going to connect and shoot those emails straight over there. So how does this work? Once you download it, it's going to ask you to go over to HubSpot.com and set up your account. Once you're in there, it's going to ask you to create what's called lead flow types. So what this basically is, again, it's kind of some form that's going to be out there on your website. So it could be a pop-up box again, it could be a drop-down banner, it could be a side shootout from the left or for the right. So what you do first here is you select which type you want to utilize. Once you select that type, you can fully customize this. You can decide what the content is, what the call-out buttons are, and again, be able to fully customize it to the design of your site so it'll fully match the colors and everything, that it won't stick out like a sore thumb and look like a third-party software. Then you can set rules for each one of these call-outs. You could decide, okay, I want this on all pages. Again, you can get really strategic and say, okay, we're going to use this call-out for people to download this free ebook. And we're going to only select to have this form show up on these 5 pages. You also can set what's called your flow triggers. So you can say, okay, only show this pop-up once someone is 50% down the page. Or actually, I want them to always, you know, see the pop-up, but, you know, let's wait 7 seconds or so to see if they're really engaged before I just instantly send them a pop-up and now they're annoyed and they're out of here anyway. They also have a nice little button here, too, where you can disable some of these based on the smaller screen sizes. Again, so you don't want to annoy people trying to utilize these things on their smartphones, where it's kind of hard to fill out forms anyway. So a lot of the times we'll just kind of delete that as well. Once you have that, you're going to be able to preview how it's going to look on your website. You're going to be able to see how it looks on desktop, on mobile, on your cell phone, as well as the tablet versions. And then you're going to be able to simply just push it live. Now that you have that plugin on, the code's already there, you don't need to get your developer involved, and now your forms are going to be showing up. So how does this work once your form's up? This is a screenshot of myself just testing one of the new setups that we did. And just by me filling out not even my work email, my Gmail, it was able to start pulling things like my photo, a description about me, some things from my Twitter handle that it associated with my Gmail account. It was able to see, you know, what pages, how I came in. Was it direct traffic? Did I come in through an organic search? Did I come in through a paid ad? What pages did I click first? And then where did I go from there to essentially fill out these forms? So what this does is once a user comes on your website, with that coding on the back end now, you're going to set kind of like a tracker, a little cookie that's on there that's going to follow them around. It's going to automatically identify and watch them every time they come. So even if they shoot out later and come back, you're going to be able to still know that that was that same user there. Once they fill out a form, now this is any form. We talked about the lead forms that we set up when we associated the account. But this is also going to track any form that's already on your website as well. So any blog post comments, any RFQs, anything like that, it's going to be able to pull in and track their data. And then once they do fill out any form of contact, you're going to receive an email with a link that goes right into your HubSpot account now, where it's going to be able to see exactly who that user was, how many interactions they had, and what pages they visited to be able to click on and go into here. So once you do that, you'll be able to come out of hiding, and you'll be like, these are the exact leads and the exact clients that marketing got. They came from organic search, they clicked our content, they clicked on this call to action next to take them to this page, and they filled out that form. We have the 6th one here. It's called Zapier. This one is not a plugin. This one is just a website. If you just Google Zapier, you'll be able to get there. What this is you just set up an account, and it's going to be great for time saving and organization. So what it is, once you register for that account, what it does essentially is it takes different programs that you might be using and it connects them together and lets them talk to together. So the great thing about this is essentially it supports over 750 different apps. So with that, any software program you're using, anything that you are utilizing within your team, your clients, odds are there's probably a Zap for that to be able to make some of these things happen. So how does this work? So this is a sample of a CRM Zap. Say you have a Facebook leads campaign out there. For those who don't know what a Facebook leads campaign is, it's an ad type in Facebook where instead of normally, you know, you see ads, you click and they make you go to your website to do some action. For the Facebook leads, what it does is it just says, hey, yeah, I want this, share my email with it, and you get it. You never have to leave Facebook, whatever. The bad side of that is that now all of these email addresses are sitting inside of Facebook for now someone who has to remember to actually go out there, grab those email addresses, and follow up with them. So what you can do here is you can set up a Zap where you connect your Facebook ad account with your CRM. So in this example, if someone's using Microsoft Dynamics, once someone fills out that lead form within Facebook, it's automatically going to pull over and create a new lead or an opportunity based on how your CRM is set up into those contacts. Another example here, Gravity Forms. If a lot of you use that within WordPress, these are, you know, a plugin to utilize with any contact form that's on your website. Some of you might use something like Contact Form 7. No matter what that is, if you're looking for a way to easily integrate all of your contact forms and automatically send and connect them into your CRM, there's also a Zap for this as well. So if someone fills out your Gravity form, which is your contact form on your page, and you now want that to go inside of Salesforce, you can just set this up on Zapier, and once someone does that, it'll automatically kind of pull that in as that opportunity. Say you're utilizing an Unbounce page. For those who don't know, this is a third-party software that allows you to create landing pages that you can easily A/B test a lot of things. It's usually used for any kind of online digital campaigns that you have out there, not to just kind of pull them back to your website, but you know, it has a clear-cut message of what you want to do. So the downside, again, of Unbounce pages is that, again, you have all of these emails sitting inside of Unbounce. Yes, you get an email that's going to, you know, send you that you have a new lead out there, but now you have all of this database of leads sitting here when you guys utilize something like Salesforce. Again, you'll be able to set up these Zaps to now connect anytime someone fills out that lead form on any of your Unbounce pages. You'll be able to send them straight into your CRM for your sales team. For the sake of time, I'm going to skip a few of these real fast, but say you're utilizing something like GoToWebinar, you have webinar registrants. You can set up a Zap as well, put them inside of your contact program. Another thing too, so you have an email program and you're using a CRM, if you want those two to talk and communicate to each other, anytime someone you add a new contact into Salesforce or vice versa, someone signs up for your e-newsletter, you can send that straight in to your CRM as well. Some project management aspects of this, if any of you guys use Basecamp or Slack out there, you can utilize these to talk to each other as well. So things like, you know, if there's a new Basecamp message in this project, send it to this Slack channel so now my team is notified without having to go into Basecamp. Vice versa, if anything happens in Slack, you can send it automatically into Basecamp. Evernote, if you guys use this, a lot with clients or any kind of meetings that you guys have out there, you're in a meeting, you're on your iPad, you're taking your notes on Evernote, and now you have to go back to your desk and you have to grab those notes, put them into a better format, and then send them out to your Basecamp to communicate with your team. Now you can kind of seamlessly do that as well. So anytime a new note is added in Evernote, you can have that connect straight into Basecamp where you can send all of that information to. Dropbox, anytime there's a new file coming in and you guys utilize Basecamp to communicate again with your team, with your client, you can send a Zap to connect these pieces as well. Emails, if you guys are using things like Eventbrite for events and getting attendees, you can utilize kind of that same thing here. So anytime you have an Eventbrite attendee, send them out to MailChimp. And then SumoMe, we talked about earlier. If for some reason your email program or your CRM wasn't inside of the SumoMe app specifically to be able to integrate, you can set up a way this way as kind of a workaround to be able to get any of those lead forms coming in and send them directly into those email or CRM programs. Okay, we're gonna go through this a little fast. Yoast, I know Ryan has talked a little bit about this, they've talked about it before. This is great if you're looking to increase organic traffic, as well as social media engagement. A lot of people don't utilize Yoast in the full for the social media aspect. So a little bit like Ryan talked about previously, there's kind of a snapshot of what a lot of you probably utilize Yoast for, kind of that basic metadata currently. You say, okay, here's my page, it's about SEO, my focus keyword is SEO, my title tag, yes, it has the reference of SEO, yes, my meta description has the reference of SEO, and that's kind of what I think a lot of people here use Yoast for, and they're not aware of a lot of the other features. One of the key things that we're seeing a lot of clients asking for and getting a lot of boost from is utilizing the social media aspect in this. So there's something called open graph tags. So anytime someone grabs a URL off of your website and shares it on your social media platform, what it's going to do is it's going to read this code on the back end, and it's going to say, okay, here's what I want to have as my title that's displayed, the image that's displayed, and the description that's displayed. So what's this going to do is it's going to allow you to have full control over your content that's and how it's being shared out there. So for example, you found this great blog, you're ready to share it. You go to Facebook, you throw in the link, and you're like, oh, this is kind of boring now. No one's going to click this. No one even knows what this is. So by utilizing these fields that we saw inside of Yoast, you'll be able to fully decide how that's being pulled into Facebook, the description, the image, headlines, all of that. So you go from the last one into this one now, where now you share that link, and automatically you're going to have control over what image is shown, what the description is as well. Also, Yoast, inside of their settings, again, like Ryan talked about previously, there's a lot of great things in here for SEO. The majority of kind of to automate more so today is sitemaps that I want to talk a little bit about. So this allows you to have full control over what content is being put into your sitemap, what Google's seeing, how often they're seeing it, how often they're coming back to crawl it. A lot of the times we see some websites out there where, you know, you guys are manually doing this. You know, you have a new blog post, and now you have to go back to your sitemap and add that new link, then submit it into Google again and say, hey, we have this new link out here. By just installing Yoast and setting up those sitemap categories, you can be able to kind of automatically add new pages and new posts directly into your sitemap without having to do that manually. And of course, there's a lot of other great technical SEO goodies here, as well as being able to do things like Ryan talked about previously as well, robot.txt, htaccess, any of that information is in here. And then the last one here that I'm going to talk about is called Zamanta. This is related posts. This is great if you guys have some content marketing initiatives, as well as if you're looking to increase your visitor engagement with your site. What this does is, again, a free WordPress plugin. You download it, and what it's going to do is it's going to kind of put at the end of all your blog posts. It's going to start pulling in other related posts. So by default, what it's going to do is it's going to grab either by a category that you say to grab it by or keywords that you want to grab it by. So say you have an article out there about SEO best practices, and you know, okay, my related posts, I want to grab it. It's in category SEO. So it's going to automatically grab and portray the different related articles out there within that category for you. As well as if you don't want it to be automated like that, you can also, when you're setting up a new post and you're like, hey, I know that there's three posts that we have that are directly correlated to this, that would be great for my users, you can also manually pick which posts are now going to be displayed here as well. So you go from kind of the old text links to the new related posts way. You know, on this the left side here, you see, you know, some link kind of hidden in there. Sometimes you don't see these, or users skip over them. You're not seeing a lot of engagement through that. So by installing an app like this, you'll be able to kind of visually display your posts and what's related to that content to get more engagement and clicks over. So we also implemented something like this. We saw an increase in the number of blog views per session. So a user that was coming into our content and then also viewed multiple blogs. So who thinks that increase was under 25%? Yeah, the related posts feature. Between 25 and 75? And over 100? Only 11%. So although it was little, we still did see a lift just by visualizing a lot of this content based on that nice visual instead of that text link now. So key takeaways, we want to work smarter, not harder. And less time can equal great results. Just because you're automating some things and you know you're not fully engaged into one thing doesn't mean that the results can't be great, as you saw here today. One more thing I want to leave you guys with, 52%, the most significant barrier to marketing automation success is the lack of effective strategy. So the last thing I want you guys to do is be like, okay, great, I have 8 awesome tools, I'm just going to download them all, and I'm just going to, you know, sit back and they're going to be awesome. Unfortunately, if you do that with not understanding where you're going and have a nice roadmap to say, okay, here's what I want to put into play and here's how I'm going to get there, you're going to find that a lot of these tools aren't going to help you, or you're just not utilizing them in the right way. So with that, someone can tweet this out. I'll tweet this out later. If you guys want to take a picture of this URL here, it's go.topfloortech.com/WordPress. And with this, what you're going to see is you guys can get obviously the slides here from today, as well as a digital strategy kit. So in this kit, I'll have a template for a full marketing calendar, so you guys can utilize to see, okay, what initiatives are you guys going to take, what should we be doing for SEO, what should we be doing for PPC, all of those different aspects. And this as well is going to be a content calendar for you. So if you guys are posting a lot, you can create that map for the year to be able to outline the different content pieces you want, hook that up to what your audience is, any keywords that you want to initiate there. So really some nice templates in here too. I think there's also a persona study map in there that'll kind of help you guys fully identify your audience so that you make sure that all those content and your marketing initiatives all align into who that audience is. So with that, I think we're a little bit over time and you guys are probably ready to eat some tacos. But if any of you have a problem specifically and you want to come see me, I can hopefully have a tool for you that you guys can utilize. Yeah, questions?
I'm really new to this. Just started using Hootsuite the other day.
Sure.
But is Jetpack, publicized by Jetpack, better than Hootsuite, the same thing? Like, what's the difference?
Yeah, so the question is, utilizing Hootsuite, how is that better from the kind of social automation that we talked about? So they both have a key purpose. So what we talked about is specifically for blog posts. So if you can kind of take that part out and automate it, now you can utilize Hootsuite to schedule out some of the things that aren't related to those blog posts. So anything specifically happening in the industry, in the company, any of your curation that you might be doing, that's still great to have that Hootsuite aspect of as well.
But a product is could be considered a post too, right?
Correct. Yep.
Hey, you mentioned content curation. So you use tools like Scoop and other content curation services?
What was that?
You use tools like Scoop and other content curation services?
I have not personally. So when I do content curation, normally it's specifically we identify who that audience is and where they hang out. And then we just have kind of like you'll see in the tool set here, a content roadmap to say, okay, here's my publications that are related to my audience, and here's what's going to be important to them. So here's things to kind of regularly go to and check to grab some content from some of those known industry publications and curate some of that.
And what about project management services like Trello?
Yeah. Yes, I think Trello is inside Zapier as well. Yep. All right. Anyone else? Okay. Let's eat some tacos.